When molten lava enters a body of water, whether that be a river, lake, sea, or ocean, it often creates a series of powerful explosions. These explosions, such as what is being shown right now on screen, represent a substantial volcanic hazard. While it may seem safe to view ocean entries of a lava flow, these explosions can occasionally generate explosions an order of magnitude larger than is typical, ejecting boulders of lava and rock that are up to several feet wide, as far as and sometimes beyond several hundred meters or feet distant. However, when lava enters a body of water, it does not always generate these explosions referred to as littoral explosions. Sometimes lava rather peacefully flows into the ocean. So, what exactly makes a lava flow generate a series of powerful explosions? And how are these explosions related to volcanic cones on the shoreline? To answer these questions, we must first understand why littoral explosions occur. Littoral explosions are somewhat similar to phreatic eruptions from volcanoes. During lava entry into a body of water, the molten rock, which in the case of basalt typically has a temperature of around 1200 degrees Celsius or 2192 degrees Fahrenheit. The lava represents a heat source, and the water near the shoreline represents a heat sink. As lava makes contact with the water, heat very quickly transfers from the lava to the water. This causes the water to near instantaneously flash to steam. Since the same mass of steam takes up more volume than the water it once was, it causes an immense amount of pressure to build. This pressure is then released upwards since it represents a path of least resistance, generating an explosion. When a lava flow initially reaches the shoreline, it typically does not generate any explosions, and if they do occur, they are quite small. The reason for this is lava at this stage of an eruption typically branches off into several paths, each of which carry volumes of molten rock. Since the heat source then falls into a large area, explosions do not occur. However, once this process has been ongoing for some time, the majority of the lava instead starts being carried by a lava tube. Thus, when it reaches the water, the same volume of the heat source is funneled into a much smaller heat sink. This passes a certain threshold, allowing for a highly energetic steam explosion to occur. To better explain the energy released in this reaction, I decided to compare it to sticks of dynamite exploding. A 10 cubic meter per second lava flow all entering the water at the same time releases approximately the same amount of energy as 5 sticks of dynamite exploding each second. However, lava deltas when they form are inherently unstable. On occasion, large segments of the edge of a lava delta, termed a lava bench, might exert so much weight on the underlying weaker sediment that causes a large section of it to collapse. This causes an even larger than normal volume of both lava and cooling volcanic rock to interact with ocean water, generating a series of incredibly powerful explosions. These types of explosions are uncommon, but are responsible for throwing boulders of rock several hundred feet distant. This is why there are generally warnings posted of volcanic eruptions where lava is entering the ocean. The restricted area may seem a bit far, but it mainly guards against the risk from the most potentially powerful explosions that may occur. Interestingly, if a body of water causes a series of explosions to occur in the same location over and over again, it can form a feature known as a littoral cone. Unlike cinder cones or stratocones, littoral cones are not directly supplied with magma from the subsurface. Rather, they form as a result of an indirect cone, which can eject lava and ash onto the surface far away from an eruptive vent. Although typically less than 20 meters in height, one littoral cone which formed during Mauna Loa's 1868 eruption measures 80 meters or 262 feet tall. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below. Additionally, I would like to thank my new YouTube member Dan Llewellyn for supporting this channel.